This is Sarah Hajjati, lab section M04, with my physics extra credit video, The Physics of Baseball. So this is based on a lecture by Professor Alan M. Nathan, and his lecture was titled Baseball and Physics, You Can Observe a Lot by Watching. So why was I interested in this topic? I've never really been interested in baseball. However, it seemed like a good time to become interested now because it's a good portrayal of physics principles. And I thought that because this subject would portrays these physics principles and now relates to my classes, it would spark more interest. It seemed interesting as far as the lecture goes, and the professor was pretty engaging. And I was interested to see how much research was done on the physics involved in baseball and how it relates in, like, the manufacturing of bats and what goes into making the baseball itself. Main points of the lecture, Dr. Nathan spoke of the baseball bat collision, how a bat works, and wood bats versus aluminum bats, what happens to the baseball in the air once it has left the bat, so the drag, the lift, etc., and fancy techniques for baseball analysis. Things I learned that I didn't previously know. The ball goes half as fast off the bat as it's initially hit. The ball becomes very deformed or squished. The yarn, the red yarn, makes up most of the baseball's friction. The bat slows down considerably after the hit, so transferring momentum to the ball. The forces are large, but the time is short, and the bat's speed matters a lot because it transfers a considerable amount of energy to the ball. So for the baseball, the coefficient of restitution, or the bounciness of the ball, is half for the baseball. It bounces to 1/4 of its initial height, and 3/4 of the energy is lost. But the bat matters as well, not just the properties of the ball. So the baseball bat is not a rigid object. It can actually vibrate. Energy that goes into the vibrating bat is dissipating energy. There are nodes on the bat, which are fixed points that are not vibrating, but the rest of the bat vibrates around it. And when a rubber bat gets hit at the bottom, the end or the handle moves only after a noticeable delay. When the reflected wave reached barrel, the collision is over. So nothing on the handle really matters, not even the grip. So the grip in the baseball bat collision, we just answered, the grip doesn't really affect the ball's path. So once the bat meets the ball, you know, the person holding it might as well just let go. So explained in physics terms, a transverse wave is created in the bat with the collision with the ball. The collision is extremely fast, less than 1/1000th of a second. So by the time the wave reflects back to the point of impact, the collision has already passed. The batted ball velocity is defined as the velocity of the ball the instant after the collision with the bat. The equation is Q versus the velocity of the pitch plus 1 plus Q times the velocity of the bat. So the coefficient in front of the velocity of the pitch is larger than the coefficient in front of the velocity of the bat. Each miles per hour of the bat speed is worth approximately 6 feet, and for the pitch speed, it's worth only like 1 foot. So this explains why a ball that's hit off of a tee usually travels farther than a bunted ball travels. So the velocity depends on the speed of the pitch, the speed of the bat, and the collision efficiency. Wooden versus aluminum bats. So which one would be more beneficial? For aluminum bats, most of the weight is centered at the player's hands, but for wooden bats, most of the weight is centered at the end of the bat. So it makes it harder to swing, actually. So the aluminum bat is easier to swing, and it sort of has something like a trampoline effect. So the aluminum bat is hollow on the inside, and the walls of the aluminum are thin and they deform, just like a trampoline. So less energy goes into compressing the aluminum bat, causing a bigger bounce afterwards, making it better. For a wooden bat, however, there's more energy that goes into compressing the ball, so it's more inefficient. This picture sort of shows how the aluminum bat is hollow on the inside versus the wooden bat. And there's also a third type of bat called the ash hardwood bat. So explaining this in physics principles, the closer the center of mass is to the handle, the lower the moments of inertia will be. That causes an elastic collision when the ball and the bat hit each other. So almost no energy is lost, and energy is transferred back to the ball after the collision with an aluminum bat. The center of mass of the aluminum bat is closer to the handle versus a wooden bat where it's farther. So my follow-up topic was how does the red yarn on the baseball contribute to the way it spins in the air, and how does the spin affect the motion of the baseball? So Newton's first law of motion is that every action is followed by an equal and opposite reaction. So a ball that is thrown up must come down And so if you were to create an experiment where you throw the baseball towards an imaginary arc, and the first time you did it with the proper grip, you threw it 3 feet high, and the second time you threw it 15 feet high. What you would see is that the ball spins faster in the higher trajectory, and it takes longer to reach the top of the arc. So the yarn affects the spin of the baseball, which affects the time it's in the air by, rotating for a longer period of time. So that is what I have to say about this lecture. Thank you for watching.